It's all good. Yeah, I'll double check with him when he wants us to start, but it'll all be right. Good.
You wanna like, you know, do some improv cycles or something?
Sure. Yeah.
We gotta, you know, spice this up.
Yeah. It's just the same thing. I was worried about you because you follow the words, right? You don't like count them. Yeah. So, you were following along. I mean, I can come back here and kind of. Yeah, exactly. Well, the only issue is we're just adding a measure of G in between, like we usually do. So, Hannah, do you mean playing a different? Like, you just mean like going wild or?
Yeah, like, you know, like jazz solos, kind of.
Sure. Yeah. go for it. We'll play. Okay. Yeah. Try it one time where you don't play the melody. We'll just play the chart. Davis, as long as you sing the melody in your head, you're good. You just won't hear what she's.
Sorry.
I come over here and sing. Yeah. I mean.
So like whenever we just have to indicate who is doing the cool like the stuff, and then yeah, and then. So if I'm improv. Well, if I'm improvising, then you have the chords, and then if you want to go wild, then I'll be very consistent with the chords. Yeah.
Okay, see how much I can get of that.
Do you guys want a cycle too? Or
I don't know. We got to see what happens.
All right, let's see this.
I wish we had 30 more minutes to do this because we could do something really cool.
Yeah. Here,
let's go. So we just played it. We just played it down one time, okay? So let's just vamp on the G one time, and this is us coming back in, okay? Ready? Hannah, you go first.
Okay.
Okay. One. So this is just vamping on the G for a measure, and then it's like we're starting the pattern over, okay? One, two. Oh, one, two, three, and G. You love the lips. Do all that, and it's only going to take half a verse to get everybody.
So upsetting.
That's awesome. Yeah, exactly. So, Davis, so I hear you kind of struggling. I'll step back and kind of sing at you. Okay. I'll just call out the chords. It's E, A, D. Well, worst comes to worst, you get stuck for a verse, and then you'll hear the melody come back in, and you come back in. Thank you. I think it's when they start coming in. I'm going to double check with Chris when he wants that to happen. Okay. Yeah. Well, we can take our little break for like 2 seconds and then come back and just start playing. We could just do that the entire time.
We'll just wait, what?
Yeah, we just play while they're out there.
Oh, I see.
Okay, yeah, let me double check with Chris.
I really liked the halftime. It sounded really good. Like, I know it was a meme, but it was funny.
Yeah, go for it. Okay, so when they're getting started. All right, y'all, so they're getting started. When we see them, they're going to go, like, all the way down the sidewalk to, like, the church office. They start moving this way as we're going to start playing, okay?
Okay.
So let's go ahead and get ready. Yes. Are you? Yeah.
Thank you.
shifted by one. Yeah, that's kind of what you have to do that with your brain.
There we go. Maybe. Kinda.
I think we got it now. Something's coming out of the speaker. No, not anymore. Going old school.
Check one. All right, David, you got that? There we go. All right. Good morning, grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to Trinity Presbyterian Church. I told him out in the parking lot, see, Presbyterians can learn new tricks. That was fun. And y'all look good doing it. So for those of you who are joining us via the internet this morning and wondering where we have been, we started in the parking lot this morning with a palm processional celebrating Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem and to our hearts. So we give thanks for a beautiful, chilly morning. Thanks to God for the opportunity to come and worship. A couple of announcements to pass your way this morning. The youth will be meeting tonight for their regular time, dinner at 6, programming at 7. And then we've got an odd schedule of events this week. Wednesday Night Live is happening on Thursday. I was asked by Renee to gently remind you that you should make reservations for that so that we know how many of you will be coming. There'll be an email that goes out tomorrow asking you to do just that. Just click on it, tell us you're coming, how many of you there are. That way we make sure we've got enough food to feed everybody. Dinner's at 5:45 on Thursday night, and as soon as dinner is over, about 7, we'll kind of clean up in between, and then we'll gather back around those same tables in McKinney Hall, and we will celebrate the Lord's Supper and Maundy Thursday's worship service. We'll gather again on Friday night at 7 o'clock for a really beautiful service of music and reading the story of the Passion. Our Good Friday service will begin at 7 in the sanctuary, and then we'll gather back Sunday morning at 9 and 11 for our celebration of the Easter event. And so we hope that you would be here for all of that. We will have an Easter egg hunt for our children in between the two worship services on Easter Sunday morning. Thanks to all of you who made the extravaganza yesterday a huge success. We had about 100 kids from the community running all over the front yard and all their parents. We started out in the sanctuary, read the Easter story, came outside and hunted eggs and made a bunch of crafts and a whole lot of laughter on a very chilly day. It was a whole lot of fun. Thanks to everyone who made that happen. Any other announcements or prayer concerns to pass along this morning? Let us stand and worship God in song.
All hail the power of Jesus. Name, let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, he ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all.
praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way. Welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Face today. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy.
Amen. Please be seated.
Friends, on this day that we come to celebrate Christ's triumphant entry into Jerusalem, we come and we sing God's praises and we shout our hosannas. And we come and acknowledge that we still fall short of the glory of God. We acknowledge that sin is very much a part of who we are, even in our best intentions. The good news is that God always refuses to let sin have the last word. And so with faith and with hope, we come and we ask God's forgiveness, praying our own silent confessions before God, and then joining our voices to pray for the sins of all of humanity. Let us pray our confessions in the silence of our hearts. Let us pray. Amen. Triumphant God, we join the crowds of the ages in shouting your praises. While our lips give you glory, our lives seldom reflect your purposes. We sing easily of your greatness, but living faithfully is often beyond us. We hear of your salvation, yet sin is still close and real, daily leading us away from you. Have mercy on us. Ride into our hearts with healing grace. Forgive what we have done and direct who we shall be. Lord, save us. Hosanna. This morning we gather and are reminded that it is in the waters of our baptism that our sin is washed clean. It is the Lord who helps us. Who is it that would declare us guilty? Only Christ Jesus. And because of the grace we have received in baptism and the love of Christ, we have nothing to fear, my friends. It is the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Let us stand and sing God's praises.
His goodness shines on me and to the Son, whose grace has pardoned me, and to the Spirit, whose love has set me free, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be. Amen. World without end, without end. World without end, without end, amen. World without end, without end, amen. As it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, amen.
Friends, we are forgiven and we are free in Christ Jesus. Let us share that peace of Christ with one another now. The peace of Christ be with you all. Peace of Christ be with you and with you more. Peace of Christ be with you all. All I can turn around and say, hey to everybody. Peace of Christ be with you all. All you know how to do this. Please be seated. Let us pray. Eternal, holy God, quiet within us all of the voices of the world around us, that we might truly hear the story of Christ's betrayal and trial, crucifixion, and resurrection, that by the power of your Holy Spirit, we too may have the same mind that was in Christ Jesus as he set his face toward Jerusalem so that he might offer himself for us. Help us to hear that good news as you proclaim it to us again. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So this morning on Palm Sunday, we are reminded of the words of the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. It is the 50th chapter of the book of Isaiah, verses 4 through 9. It is the story of the suffering servant. Hear now this reading from God's holy word to the church today. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. God who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who is it that will declare me guilty? My friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now I would invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel. This is the reading from Luke's gospel account, the 22nd chapter, verses 22 through 33. For the Son of Man is going as it has been determined, but woe to that one by whom he is betrayed. Then they began to ask one another which one of them it could be that would do this. A dispute also arose among them as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? But I among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you, just as my Father has conferred on me, a kingdom, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, listen. Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat, but I have prayed for you that your own faith may not fail. And you, when once you have turned back, strengthen your brothers." And Simon said to Jesus, "Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison or even to death." Jesus said, "I tell you, Peter, the cock will not crow this day until you have denied three times that you know me." My friends, this is the gospel of our Christ. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. Today is a joyful celebration. We meet Jesus sitting on a donkey, riding down the Mount of Olives and up to Jerusalem. It is an idiosyncrasy of the Hebrew language that you always go up to Jerusalem. It's not the highest point in Israel, but Jerusalem sits on a mountain in the midst of a valley, and you really do always go up to the gates of Jerusalem. The Mount of Olives overlooks all of Jerusalem, and Jesus, we're told, starts there praying with his disciples and then riding down the Mount of Olives and up up into the city of Jerusalem. And as Jesus gets closer and closer to the gates of Jerusalem, the people are there celebrating the arrival of the Son of David. They all know, theoretically, that this man, this rabbi, this Son of David, theoretically could replace Herod as king. Not Herod the Great, mind you, but his son, Herod. The people, always hopeful that the political class will make things easier on them, saw in Jesus hope of a new Israel. Hope that Israel would once again regain its status and conquer its Roman invaders to restore the former independent glory of the state of Israel. The people had no way of knowing that one of Jesus' followers had already surmised that Jesus had no intention of recreating the Davidic kingdom of Israel. And so they stood along the roads with throwing their cloaks out over the cobblestones and waving their palm branches and singing hosannas and praising the day that God would restore the Davidic kingdom. Judas had already figured out that was not Jesus' intention. Jesus came into the world to reconnect us to God. Jesus came into the world to remind us that the God of all creation, the God of everything, desired us to live in community the way God created us to be. Jesus never wanted to be a king. God never really wanted Israel to have a king. God always told them, "I am your king." And yet the people demanded and demanded, and God relented and raised up prophets to keep the kings in check and told them, "Careful what you wish for." That disconnect of what the people want and what God offers has always been the tension between those of us who were created by God and the God who longs to be in relationship with us. You see, that's what God offers us in Jesus. The way to be in perfect relationship with God. And yet we still struggle. It's the heart of the conflict of how we define discipleship. Are we going to follow Jesus? Are we going to follow in Jesus' ways, allowing God to be our guide? Are we going to be a servant among God's people? Or do we believe that we've got a better way? That we can be in control, we can be in charge, and God will bless our efforts of us doing whatever it is that we long to do. You see, that's the story we tell ourselves, right? That God's okay with us doing that. As long as I'm in charge, it's all good. But God's the one that longs to be in charge and continues to let us practice trying to get it right. Now, we already know the story. We know this story that Judas has already decided that Jesus has betrayed his cause. Judas the Zealot, who wanted to overthrow Rome with an insurrection, a military coup. Judas already knew that Jesus wasn't going to be a part of that. Judas also had decided that it was up to him to get Jesus out of the way so that he might find a leader that would help Judas and the Zealots restore Israel's independence and glory. Now we know, because we read the story, we know the story, that Jesus, of course, never wanted any of that. He was always clear from the very beginning. He came into this world so that we might have life, that we might find life in the God who created us, the God who redeems us and forgives us and calls us to a new way of life. Jesus came into the world that we might come to understand that love is the very foundation of all relationships with God and with one another. Jesus tells that story over and over and over again. The love of the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. But you see, that's not the message that many of the people in Jesus' day wanted to hear. It's not really even the message that folks in our day really want to hear. Because it is so much easier to pit one group against another, to demonize those that think differently, those that look differently, those that practice their faith in ways that may be foreign to us. It is just easier to criticize and to demonize than it is to sit at table and learn from one another. But Jesus welcomed all of them. Jesus proclaimed the same message of love and forgiveness to everyone that would stop and listen. Jesus went so far to ask us to do the same. That was a step too far for Judas. Maybe it's even a step too far for all of us. It's okay if Jesus wants to be that way, but that's asking too much of us, Jesus. Don't expect that of us. All of those people standing along the corridors of the alleyways of Jerusalem, screaming Hosanna as Jesus parades by on the back of that donkey. The disciples whipping them up to scream, Hosanna in the highest, welcome the one who comes in the name of the Son of David. Even the Pharisees go to the disciples and say, you got to tell Jesus to stop this. They're out to kill him. Don't you get it? Jesus overhears them and laughs and says, no, you don't get it. Even if these people were silent, the very stones of Jerusalem would shout out. Again, we know the story. Those same people screaming Hosanna just in a few days are going to be screaming, crucify him. Crucify him. Nobody asked the people to stop making that noise. You and I long to celebrate the good news that Jesus dies for our sin. We point to this passage in Isaiah that we read this morning. The image of the suffering servant is proof that Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy that Isaiah pointed to the person that Jesus would be, a teacher, one among us who offers himself up to ridicule and torture, knowing that God would vindicate him. It is the good news, my friends. It is our good news. Good news that God would not be undone by our hate. What would be even better good news would be a people who claim Jesus as their Lord and Savior and who model Jesus' behavior of loving, forgiving, and accepting others. Not only the people that are easy to accept, but to go out of our way to accept all of God's people. You see, unlike the crowds that made noise around Jesus celebrating him and then betraying him and then ultimately calling for his death, the noise that Jesus made in this world calls us to act in a new way. And there is nothing easy about living the way Jesus calls us to live. Because it's hard work to forego our own biases. Those built-in biases that tell us to distrust people or to point at people that are different or to avoid people that make us uncomfortable. It's hard work to forego all of that stuff that's built into us, to welcome the stranger, to sit with those that we don't understand, to forgive those who have hurt us, even to forgive those who have hurt the people that we love. That's living a life the way Jesus lived his life. And maybe, just maybe, on our best days, we can fool ourselves into thinking, oh, yeah, I can do that. I can do that. Peter did. Peter thought that he could do that. Peter thought that he could remove the politics from the way we live. Peter thought that he could stand up and be bold and stand with Jesus, even to death. Jesus looks at his dear friend and he said, I know, Peter. And before the end of this day, you will have denied knowing me three times. Palm Sunday it's an awkward day in the Christian year. We start out with a parade. We start out waving palm branches and singing praises and great upbeat music, and it's all fun. It's great. But see, here's the problem. If you came to church today and you didn't hear anything but that celebration of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and because of our crazy, hectic schedules, you don't make it back on Thursday or you don't make it back on Friday to hear the painful, suffering rejection of Jesus. And then you come back next Sunday and we're celebrating the resurrection, then you came for a triumphal parade and you came back for the joyful celebration of the resurrection, and you miss all of the suffering and betrayal and pain. And so somehow or another, we've got to be reminded that it's not one parade leading to the resurrection, but it's a parade that leads to a terrible, awful, painful week in the life of Christ. And in the midst of all of that, there are all these people making all of this noise, celebrating Jesus coming into town and then later calling for his death, and people trying to do the right thing and they don't. And so are we just making noise when we profess our faith in Jesus? Or are we really trying to live a life transformed by Christ's love for each of us? That starts getting at the heart of the questions of Holy Week. Those stones that Jesus said would shout out if the people were quiet, are those stones from the streets of Jerusalem more faithful to the call of discipleship than those of us who profess our faith in Jesus? That's the question. It's a question that only we can answer. And it's not about the words that we say as much as it is about the way that we act. That's what makes this week so terribly hard. The questions are real. And like our mothers taught us so long ago, it's not about what we say, it's about what we do. Actions speak louder than words. It's our actions, loving those around us, the way Jesus first loved us, everything else is simply making noise. And so I invite you now to stand and affirm your faith, making some noise. Noise about the way the Spirit moves through us and calls us to live in the world. What is it that we believe to be true about God? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. Most holy God, we gather in your presence, reminded of the celebrations and the struggles of this life. We give you thanks that we can be reminded that Jesus had set his face like flint, set his face toward Jerusalem, knowing that he was going toward a cross that had his name on it, knowing that the politics of his day, much like the politics of our day, get in the way of us being faithful to you. Doesn't matter which side of the aisle we sit on. We put our faith in people that really can't save us, and yet we think they can make life better when only you can make the world a better place. Help us to be reminded again and again of your love for us, for the ways in which you call to us and forgive us, that you set us on a right path and journey alongside us, calling us to live a life that bears witness to the glory and the love of the Christ who first loved us. We pray that you would remind us that we are new creations, washed clean of our sin, and called to a new way of life, a way of life that models love and forgiveness, that calls us to work for the reconciliation of the world in the way that you have tried to reconcile all of us to live together in harmony. It doesn't take much to be reminded that the world is not living harmoniously. Parts of our world are at war. The violence and the destruction presented to us day by day. We pray that you, the great peacemaker, would move your spirit among us and help us find a way to peace. That you could help us find a way to make love the foundation of the way we treat one another. We pray that your spirit of healing would rest with those that are facing surgeries, for those who are struggling with illness and disease, for those that are suffering from loneliness and betrayal. Let your spirit nurture our souls and restore our hearts, reminding us of the love that you have for us and that you have surrounded us with a community of faith, not only to care for us, but model that good news in our own lives. We We pray, most holy God, that in this holy week that we might find a way to ask the questions of who you are calling us to be, and to be bold enough to follow you along that path. And now we pray that you might incline your ear and hear us praying as your Son taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Good morning and welcome again to Trinity Presbyterian Church, especially those of you who are joining us via the internet this morning. Thank you for taking the time to log in and be a part of the worshiping community this morning. Thanks to all of you who are here on this beautiful Palm Sunday morning for being able to process in and hear the good news of how God is calling us to live and to be in this world. For those of you who are visiting with us today, thank you for your presence with us. You'll notice on the tables around the room there are a couple of little green cards. If you would be so kind as to just give us a name and an email address, it's not because we want to bug you. It's really because we want to give thanks to God for your presence with us and just touch base with you once or twice to make sure you don't have any questions that we might help you with, and certainly to invite you back to let you know that we are truly grateful for your presence with us this morning. Thanks to all of you who have come to share your gifts in worship this morning, the gift of singing and praying, the gift of yourselves before God. We give you thanks for the gifts that you bring to sustain us in the ministry that God has called us to be about. And during the last hymn, you are invited to share those gifts in the baskets that are back behind the AV table. We will bless those gifts and give thanks to God for you, the giver, and for the gifts received as we use them to continue the ministry God has called us to be about together. Friends, let us stand and sing together.
Oh, sacred head, now wounded, with grief and shame weighed down, now scornfully surrounded, with thorns thine only crown. Oh, sacred head, what glory, what bliss till now was thine. Yet though despise and glory, I joy to call thee mine. What thou, my Lord, hast suffered was all for sinners' sake. Mine was the transgression, but thine the deadly pain. Oh, here I for my Savior, tis I deserve thy praise. Look on me with thy favor, and grant to me thy what language shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend, for this thy dying sorrow, thy pity without end? Oh, make me thine forever, and should I faint in Lord, let me never, never outlive my love to thee, outlive my love to thee.
So friends, as you go back into this holy week, out into God's good creation, go with the reminder that it is the way that we live our life as a disciple of Christ that is our greatest testimony to a world that is in pain and broken, a world that needs to hear the good news of God's love more and more each day. Let your lives be a testament to that good news in all that you do as you go with the blessings of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Go in peace.